it's a long way down to the bottom of the river. Oh, my head. Oh, baby, it's a long way down, a long way down. It's late, it's waiting enough.
They were throwing their torches in houses, And Dr. Fletcher started beating this girl until I could see the blood on his boots. And then he bent down and said something to the girl. And then he took something shiny from him. I couldn't make out what it was. So as I was finishing up my knitting for the night, a man throws his torch into my window, and all I seen were the flames all through my home.
First came the night terrors. Back in the war between the states, I racked up quite a bounty. I was quick with my wit and even quicker with a pistol. But I wasn't quick enough to realize They'd come to claim my bounty, but it wasn't me they'd come for. When they grabbed Janine and Jack, I broke. I didn't know what to say. Jack was too young to understand. Why ain't Mama moving? Who are these men? What'd they do to Mama? I didn't know what to tell him. All I could say was, Jack, it'll be okay, bub. Stay right there. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Papa loves you, bub. Close your eyes. Now, it's ironic that the last thing that he heard me telling him was, close your eyes, because that's the one thing that I could not do comfortably anymore. But every single time that I did, gave me fuel. It kept me going. And I had one goal. Find the man that put a bullet through the lights of my life. Do what I should have done a long time ago. Fate has a funny way of playing jokes on you. By the time I found out where he'd been hiding, turns out it was in a graveyard. Died of cholera a year back. Now, I didn't have much purpose left after that. But I did have one thing left to keep me comfortable. I found a pretty old woman of light left to keep me warm during my nights. And she was real good at what she did. Madam BB, they called her. She was the real independent type of woman. But I ended up falling too deep in her line of work. That ain't something you can do. She ended up leaving, just like everyone else in my life in one way or another. I guess you could say that, in a way, I was seeking death. But in the end, I couldn't even achieve that. Lived till 67, slinging and drinking, slinging and drinking, slinging and drinking. Nowadays, I don't dream no more. You can't dream when you're 6 feet under the dirt without no name on your grave. Ain't nobody know me. Ain't nobody knew my wife or my kid. And ain't no one give a damn.
I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, and I fear no evil, cause I'm blind to it all. In my mind, my gun, it comforts me, cause I know I'll kill my enemies when they come. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell on this earth forever. Storm walk on the path of the right, because I'm wrong.
Immorality or of any kind of impurity or of greed, for these are improper for God's holy people. You see, my mama, she made me read that book almost as soon as I could say my ABCs. I wish I could sit here and tell you that mama hated me or daddy beat me and that's why I crave the gentle touch of a man. That weren't true. They really were God's holy people. After Daddy died and President Abraham Lincoln war, Mama took that real bad and she followed right after. So there I was at 14 years old with the choice I had to make. I could stay and give my love to a man that I didn't love, or I could move to Louisville and see the elephants and wake the snakes. So I picked out my prettiest dress and I shoved it on out. Not quite a woman, but not no child, neither. I had a high price on my collar. Started meeting some fellas, and they were treating me real nice. Soon enough, I had a whole host of girls coming to me with their problems, asking me for advice. And then I met this boy. This man. He was fast, but not like that. He was a dangerous man, so he was feared by most, but I could tell that he had a broken soul. And then I realized I had another choice to make. I could stay with this man, or I could stay with this business. So I said goodbye to that gunslinger, bought a house on Market Street, and I became Madam Beebe. Now you see, my profession may not be the most moral, but it got me to where I needed to be. And as I look back on all those choices I made, I wonder, did I do my life wrong? Hell no.
Woo! There was one thing I knew, it was horses. I knew thoroughbreds, I knew mixed, I knew stallions, and I knew fillies. And I've been spending my whole life over on the farm in central Kentucky. I knew horses, and ain't nobody tell me different. Ain't so likely that they raise horses themselves. At least I don't think so. But I heard of Churchill Downs opening over in Louisville. And I wondered to myself a few nights, seeing that this may be an opportunity for me and my family to be successful, to make more money than we ever made on this farm. And yes, I know that this farm was carried down generation to generation from father to father. And after a while, I decided it was time to move to Louisville. My wife was against it, but I knew what's right for a family, so I took her and the three kids, and we moved over to Louisville to the closest place near Churchill Downs. Eventually, I knew she'd come around, because after my first win, she wanted me to do more, so I quit my job. And that's all I did was gamble on these horses, because they kept running and running and running, and the crowd kept cheering and cheering, and woo! When I came home, I guess we didn't have much to eat, so we made cornbread and beans for about a day or two, or maybe a little more than that, but when I won, I made sure that we ate, I made sure that we didn't have to worry about the bills. And then one night, first Kentucky Derby come, I bet on this horse, Aristides. And it ran and ran and ran and it won, and I got $1,000. I was ready to come home and tell my family, we didn't need to worry about anything anymore. Win or lose, we were gonna be stacked with money. We won't need any more. And I come home and I open the door, ready to give my kids a hug and my wife a kiss, but there was nothing but a move. I guess, even when I win, I'll lose.
She has my beautiful daughter. I have rest in peace. my beautiful daughter, rest in peace. My beautiful daughter, rest in peace.
Oh, grave can hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, I'm going to rise right out of the ground. Ain't no grave can hold my body down. Well, look way down the river. I see a band of angels, they're coming after me.
Ain't no grave can hold my body down. Ain't no grave can hold my body down.
Well, look down yonder, Gabriel, with your feet on the land and sea. Gabriel, blow your trumpet until you hear from me.
Ain't no grave can hold my body down. Ain't no grave can hold my body down.
Lead me, mother and father, lead me down the river road. And mama, you'll know I'll be there when I shed my load.
Ain't no grave can hold my body down. Ain't no grave can hold my body down. Ain't no grave can hold my body down. Ain't no grave can hold my.
There will be a short intermission. Go get some popcorn, go get some drinks. It helps.
When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the stand by me. In the midst of tribulation, stand by me. In the midst of tribulation, stand by me. When the host of hell assail and my strength begins to fail, then who knows? When I'm growing old and feeble, stand by me. When I'm growing old and feeble, stand by me. When my life becomes a burden and I need chilly Jordan, oh, the lily of the valley, stand by me.
Stand by me. The arguments. Oh my gosh, the arguments. She will always complain how I left my clothes outside in the rain. I left my dirty underwear on the floor. And her voice sounds like a herd of pigs on Thanksgiving morning.
He was saying my voice sounds like some pig or something when he sounded como una vaca muriéndose.
And she always speaking that jibber jabber. Like, what the heck is an idiot?
He was saying he don't know what I'm saying when I speak Spanish, which I knew he would understand me, idiota.
But in the end, love, loyalty, and caring is what kept us together.
I is Dr. Peter Chatwell. I die in my place of work. Now most people would see that as sad, but you can't help but sense at least a little irony. It wasn't even a freak accident or anything. At least then it would have been an interesting case. But a tiny bug. Spanish flu. Symptoms include coughing, vomiting, nausea, and in some cases, insanity. The last one in particular with one of my patients was quite obsessed with me. Didn't see anything in return. But one day, I just had to stop, drop it all, and leave without a trace. Become a failure in my profession. Instead of the one working on the patients, becoming a patient myself. Didn't live much longer to screw anything else up. That being said though, it still stings.
Voices. We were fine, we were fine. And one day, we weren't fine, we were sick with some kind of flu, a flu, the Spanish flu. I got real sick. Real. We got real sick. I had two options. I could go with the doctors and let them comb our brain and poke around. What if they could see my secrets? We weren't okay with that. Oh, second option was Waverly Institution. It was beautiful. And even more beautiful was a doctor. He was beautiful, handsome, magnificent. Oh. Every morning, he'd come into our room and say, "Hello, how are you?" And we'd say, "We're good." He was in love with us. He vanished, disappeared. We didn't know how to cope, so they brought in a preacher. I could tell, we could tell he was just as miserable as the rest of us. I'm not crazy. We're not crazy. I'm not crazy. Oh, death. Oh, death. Oh, death. Won't you spare? I can't see as cold hands taking hold of me, oh death. When God is gone, the devil takes all mercy on your soul, oh death. Oh death. No wealth, no moon, no silver, no nothing except death to end it all.
I've been called inmate there in the home for friendless women. That's what they call us poor old unmarried pregnant women. Mama went there while she was pregnant with me, and after she had me, she took off. I never knew my mother, and I was born there, so when they told me she had died, I took it as an opportunity to go out and see the outside world. So I packed the little things that I had and I left. When I stepped outside, I instantly got lightheaded. I could taste the pollen from the flowers. I could smell the cheeseburgers from Kaylin's restaurant down the road. I hoofed it to Russell, and as soon as I got there, I turned right back around. You know why? Because Mama didn't come back for me, so I'm not coming back for her.
Did these things, but I didn't know I didn't want to be anything like them. I wanted to be better. I wanted to be a teacher, and that's exactly what I did. And it was tough. It was very tough. especially being a man of my color. I mean, I can remember a group of white boys knocking me down to the ground so hard and beating me up for no reason. And as much as I wanted to strike back at each and every last one of them with all my anger, I just chose to get up and walk away. Because I knew that sometimes you have to get knocked down lower than you've ever been so that you can stand back up taller than you ever were. One small crack does not mean that you're broken. It means that you were put to the test and you didn't fall apart. You get knocked down 6 times, get back up 7. See, when I look at this crowd, I see bold, talented, intelligent, beautiful women, strong and powerful men. Each and every last one of you women are beautiful, and I think any man would be a fool not to recognize it. My men out here, brothers, each and every last one of you are powerful. Act like it. Matter of fact, when y'all go home, I want you to look in the mirror and see your beautiful reflection, because that's what exactly each and every last one of you are. I see leaders, and I know that some of you are going through a lot. I know it. It's a fight you have to put up. This world wasn't meant to be easy. But you need to know that sometimes good things have to fall apart so better things can fall together. It's going to get better. I promise. See, because today, you all leave the school. And tomorrow, you leave the world.
Look at me. Don't I look pretty? I sure did leave a beautiful corpse. How do you like the dress Daddy picked out for me? It's not bad on me, though personally I prefer a little more silk. You see, I didn't make this one. No, Daddy wouldn't have had me one of my own. They're all much too glamorous for his taste, that old J-nose. I'd be the berries had I had my own touch to this one. Little fringe at the bottom, some sequins at the top. A whole hell of a lot shorter. Speaking as someone who'd sewn her own dresses for years, I'd say this dress has got some real potential. So did I. See, everybody always told me, Rosetta, you're gonna be a movie star one day. It was a dream of mine, after all. I wanted to be the next It Girl, like Clara Gordon Bell, star in a big production like The Jazz Singer or a Busby Breathed musical. I guess you could say it just wasn't in the cards for me. I learned that in the cruelest way I could. I saw an advertisement in the Sunday paper. There were gonna be auditions just over the river for the cabinet of Dr. Caligari. When I saw it, I remembered what my mom had told me before she passed, that I had to take the first opportunity I see. My dreams are as real as I want them to be. So the day of auditions, I did it up real nice. I wore my prettiest fringe, my hair big and curly. I was sitting up in meeting on the telephone with one of my girlfriends, and well, the dinner, Daddy was listening. And he snapped. Where the hell are you going dressed like a hussy? He grabbed me by the wrist real tight. I saw this look in his eyes, this look of pure, uncut hatred. I saw the devil in his eyes. He dragged me like a dog to the backyard, and I fell, and he kicked me, and kicked me, and kicked me, until I saw blood coming from me, but I didn't know where I was bleeding from. And I felt nothing. The last thing I heard was my daddy tell me, you're supposed to be my little girl.
She was supposed to be my little girl. But it was either her or me, I swear to God, it was never my intention to hurt her. And I'm sorry, baby girl. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, that's not true. I got so tired of people coming up to me saying, sorry for your loss, she was such a good girl. What kind of a good girl walks out of the house looking like a hussy? But no, let me tell you, that girl never wore a dress past her fingertips. Until I buried her in a dress of my choice. My real loss was my humanity. Don't get me wrong, I went through the emotions and I played my part. Just like her mother. She was just like her mother. That's the thing. I didn't feel anything. When I killed them, I wasn't sad or angry. I didn't even hesitate. I just did it.
I have some.